Good morning. Thank you for attending our High Impact Care Hazard webinar today, our TMIT High Performer webinar series. This is our 90th webinar today. This is Charles Denham. I am the chairman of TMIT, and I'll be hosting and emceeing today. And we are really delighted to have a great team today on some pretty important topics. However, they're not right in the sweet spot of our typical patient safety officers. However, we've heard the demand to be very, very, very serious and focused for the problems and challenges we'll face. First off, on slide 3, for those that are on the slides, we want to make sure that you turn your volume up to the max on your computer to make sure that you get the best audio possible. After you do that, if you can't get good audio and have difficulty hearing, go up to the participants section on the menu bar, click on that, and then request phone to get a toll-in dial-in number and a landline. I'm on slide 5. For those of you that don't have the slides yet, please go to www.safetyleaders.org, our landing page, and in the upper right quadrant of the landing page, you can click on May 19th, the High Impact Care Hazards webinar, and that'll take you to the page to download the slides. But it also, in future, we'll be adding more and more resources regarding these topics, which are a collection of topics that are high impact care hazards, and we'll be adding content. You'll be able to go and watch the video or watch the presentation and videos that we'll have posted there. And we will, over the weeks ahead, we anticipate there'll be a lot of interest in this topic, and we'll be posting additional information. On slide 7, are our social media addresses, and I'll just move quickly through that to slide 8, which are our purpose statement. So our purpose at TMIT, and it's so exciting for me to host our 90th monthly webinar. Now, we've done way over 100 total webinars and maybe 150, but this is our 90th monthly unbroken sequence of webinars to this audience and this network. And so we're excited about that. And our purpose is that we will measure our success by how we protect and enrich the lives of families, patients, and caregivers. And this topic set really address those in kind of an interesting way, and are not the typical patient safety targets that we see that our patient safety officers in acute care hospitals are focused on. We're now talking about communities, and we're talking about our caregivers and the families of our caregivers. So it's exciting to really be able to meet that purpose. Our mission is to accelerate performance solutions that save lives, save money, and create value in the communities that we serve. And we're delighted to have our audience on board today, and that our on-demand audience who will watch this in the future. On slide 9 is a disclosure statement. No products or services will be presented for which any of the speakers have any relationship. We will be talking about the Narcan Epi-like pen devices that are used to reverse opioid overdoses. However, none of us have any relationship with the company that produces Narcan or the devices or services that relate to them. Our speakers today include Dr. Greg Botz, who will be our first speaker, who's at Stanford right now and flying on helicopters and teaching trauma nurses about the high impact care hazards. And so we'll have part of his presentation recorded. We have Christopher Peabody, Dr. Toph Peabody, who is a clinical faculty at the University of California in San Francisco, who will be giving us kind of a sum up of his perspective as an emergency medicine leader and clinician, and a global leader, actually, in patient safety. And we have Jennifer Dingman and Arlene Salamandra, who are patient safety champions, who are published authors in patient safety, and relentless and tireless workers on behalf of patients and families. And then we have Blake Settle, college student who's a clinical chemical engineering student destined for medical school, and Stephanie Settle, who is also a student at the University of Texas in Austin, who are both leading projects, and we'll have more and more young people leading projects that will help them deliver value to the broad community of younger people, but also have a global impact in their two programs that they will, then they'll respond as responders and on some of the topics. And So before we start, as always, we'd like to have the voice of the patient and family today. And it's very pertinent because we're covering children from K to 12 through college age and our caregivers in hospitals. So it's the full continuum of the people that are very close to us and very important to us. And no better person than Jennifer Dingman to set us off with a 30-second, you know, setting our focus for today. Jennifer.
Thanks, Dr. Denham. Just want to welcome everyone who is here today to this very important webinar. This subject is something that is a big crisis here in the 21st century, and I'm so very grateful for all of the work that's being done on this by the great people on this webinar and others who have been on webinars in the past. And this is just something that is so near and dear to my heart. I live in a town where we have a real big problem with some of these issues. So I just want to thank you all for being and tell your friends and share the recording with others after this is over. And I'll hand it back to you, Dr. Denham. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Jennifer. And, you know, these issues that pertain to the life and death consequences of some of these medications are absolutely critical. So I'm going to cover a news update of some of the reports that have come out that are really pertinent to the topics of today. And it's interesting that a number of major reports have come out since our last webinar and our opioid polling. The first is one, and those of you that are patient safety officers are aware of the BMJ article that just came out addressing medical error. Now, we've been saying that medical error is the third leading cause of death in the United States. This is yet one more article that addresses this issue. And Mari Makary is one of the authors of this report, who is one of our speakers and has been tireless proponent of accountability. His article, his book, Accountable, a bestseller, we captured in one of our webinars with CMS, with the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid. We put the graphic up that's in this article that addresses the causes. And one of the things that we really need to think about is when you add in the CDC causes of death related to infections, you look at the other reports from the GAO on seniors, the IOM report to Eris Human, and then Dr. James' report in the Journal of Patient Safety, you're starting to get a view that consistently we're seeing that the numbers are ever bigger. People could debate about the categories, but certainly they're far in excess of the 98,000 that were in 1999, so many years ago, that came from the Harvard study with our colleagues at Harvard with Dr. Lucian Leaf that reported on New York. Now, a report just came out. It says March 2016. The release date was after that date, and it addresses workplace safety and health. Now, why is that important to you? It's important that three federal data sets were reviewed by GAO. And, for example, in 2013, the most recent year that data was available, when they compared private sector and healthcare workers, it appears that healthcare workers have workplace violence-related injuries estimated to be five times higher than the rate for private sector workers overall. And in the prior webinar, we reported that more than a third of the call-in lines on bullying hotlines are nurses. So we just grabbed a couple of slides from this report. We really recommend that you look at it. If you look at Pompey and others, you look at 39% of healthcare workers experience workplace violence. The kinds of violence are assaults, physical threats, verbal abuse. The patient, 76% of the events were patients, and 24% visitors. Now, we also know bullying by staff is a big issue, and it's interesting that the Institute of Medicine, formerly called the Institute of Medicine, now called the National Academy of Medicine, and I was honored to be on their president circle for a decade. The Institute of Medicine, again, was the academies were established by President Lincoln to be an unbiased top-flight set of scientists who could report to Congress. They did a study on bullying, and this now ties to the threat management issues that we've been covering. Now, interestingly, there appeared to be not enough evidence to conclude that bullying is a causal factor for suicides and in school shootings. And so what we see is the press exaggerates the beliefs out there. However, we want to add a proviso here that the data that's reported in articles. There are very few articles on this, and I think it's very self-evident to most that study the area that bullying is a major factor that leads to violence, a major contributor, not the only, but the studies are not there yet, so let's not overclaim them, but I think that's one of the limits of just looking at evidence alone. There's also a slide here from that the causes of death in K through 12 children that we inserted here so that you could kind of get a view and see the prevalence of different types of bullying of students. What I'm going to do right now is play, is I'm going to have Kyle play the audio of a video. The video will be posted on our website so that you can watch it, but here I'm in Houston, Texas right now at one of the frequent flyer lounges running this webinar, and I've spent all week in Houston. But this news program came on as we were analyzing our opioid polling responses from all of you, and we think it's pertinent. So Kyle, would you please play this news clip?
UT students are working to get a drug that could save people who overdose on opioids. It's called a save shot. The plan is to get it into the hands of resident advisors and campus police. The Nightbeat's Brandon Jones joins us now here in the studio. Brandon, not everyone is on board, but I hear the UT student government just approved this resolution.
Yeah, they did, Tyler, and the vote was unanimous among the student government. Now, opiate abuse is very prevalent among 18 to 24-year-olds. The school wouldn't release how many overdose cases happen on campus. However, the CDC says opioids killed more than 28,000 people in 2014. That is more than any year on record, and at least half of all opioid overdose deaths involve a prescription.
Meet Stephanie Hemborski. She's a UT student, and some of her college experiences haven't been easy. Hemborski witnessed the abuse of opiates like heroin and prescription drugs.
I haven't personally lost anyone to an overdose, but I have a lot of friends who have.
Hemborski is one of the front runners on a resolution UT student government passed last week to get a drug in the school pharmacy that stops people from overdosing.
We do know that Texas is one of the states that is utilizing the most funds on dealing with opioid overdose and misuse.
Hemborski says a ready supply of the drug naloxone is going to be the key. It's a life-saving drug that reverses the effects of opiate use. The plan is to give a vial to RAs and campus police when a student is overdosing.
When they are high on whatever opiate they're using and they receive a naloxone shot, they immediately, when they come to and start breathing again, they're undergoing withdrawal symptoms.
Hemborski says they've already received support from the school pharmacy and doctors. However, some worry about the message this safe shot could send to students.
Like, they would think that because they have that, they could just keep on abusing it.
That's just not the case. A lot of people, from my experience, that are using opioids don't want to be using them, and a lot of them are seeking care and trying to get off of them.
While the logistics of how many vials will be distributed or where the money will come from to support the safe shot, Hemborski says the next step is approval from President Finves. She hopes he gives it the green light and more lives are saved. In Austin, Brandon Jones, KVU News, Nightbeat.
So this is a critical area, and we have one of the UT students on as one of our reactors, since this has become one of the top five leading causes of death of high school students, and actually students K through 12. Just want to remind everyone that earlier we showed video from a 2020 program where they were training the students on the use of this, and Dr. Botz will address a device that actually delivers it like an EpiPen. So Dr. Gladstone McDowell presented the opioid patient safety crisis actions and reactions to what was going on with the FDA and the CDC. That we reported in the last month. And this slide is from his presentation. And for those that have not seen it, nearly all the people that used heroin also used at least one other drug. It turns out that the release of the short-acting opioid starting in 1999 has driven an amazing transition to heroin, and the mean time to move from prescription drugs to heroin is amazing because you can get four hits of heroin for the price of one pill out on the street. And so when people who are addicted to alcohol are two times more likely to be addicted to heroin. And if you look at the other end of the continuum, people that are on addicted to opioids are 40 times, which is just an amazing number, which we pulled from Dr. McDowell's presentation. If you look at the 2010 to 2013 heroin-related overdose deaths, and now we know from last year we had 47,000 preventable deaths due to drug overdoses, so it's the leading cause of accidental death now, and you look at the rise in heroin deaths, it's directly linked and directly related to these short-acting opioids, and we'll have Dr. Peabody address this. So we ask you, I would like a multidisciplinary webinar led by health system patient safety leaders who have opioid safety programs, and this is what you told us. 96% of you agreed. This was our polling last month, and because we see 53% of you gave it a 10, we are on the search right now, and if you want to email us or let us know of those systems that you think have done a great job, we will get them on as speakers, because you can see 96% agreed, 53% gave it a 10, 73% gave it a 9 or a 10. We asked the question where we made the statement and had you respond to the statement. I would like clarity on integrating CDC and FDA requirements and guidelines to make them actionable. 94% of you agreed, 57% gave it a 10, 13% a 9, because we need some clarity, and then we need to take that to our senior leadership teams and boards to be able to craft what we've got to do to address the new guidelines, especially those of you that have integrated across ambulatory networks. We tested this statement. I would like best practices toolkit for opioid use and pain management for primary care to help primary care physicians actually make the right choices for pain management. And this is rarely have we ever had such a high response. 69% of our audience gave it a 10, 12, a 9, and on down. So 96% agreed, but almost 70% gave it a 10. So we are going to be helping develop and identify the toolkits that are available and maybe what could be developed. And Dr. Gladstone McDowell will help lead us with that. The next question was, I believe pain management, including drug diversion, and this is, for those of you that don't know drug diversion, those are when our own staff are diverting drugs for their own use from patients. I believe that pain management, including drug diversion, could be included in a threat management program that's across the board. And 80% agreed, 40% of you gave it a 10. So we are definitely going to focus on this in future programs. Now, we wanted to give you back, you know, you are so gracious about giving us detail of what you would like to see in an opioid safety program, and you can see that and we have multiple slides here, and I'm not going to read each of the bullets, but you gave us a great review of what you really want to see: pain management, how to deal with pain medication seekers, alternative therapies, diversion and substance use, ED, TOF, you'll see that there are multiple requests regarding the emergency department. It's really a multidisciplinary team that could answer the questions that you all want. And so we're going to address these. I'm on a second page on what other training topics, and these are in alphabetical order. So you can see that you all gave us issues regarding monitoring and PENS and opioid use and healthcare professionals and anti-drug diversion strategies popped up multiple times. Steps prior to opioid trial, changes in the laws. We ask, what major questions would you want to answer? And I'll give you a moment to see these, but I won't read them. A number of them were terrific questions, and so we're going to construct a webinar series, probably two at the least, that will address this opioid crisis and pain management, because not only do you want to know, well, there's a crisis, but you also want to know, well, what do I do about it, and what can I do in my clinics in Tufts? I think you could really help us with some of the latest thinking in the emergency departments on dealing with this issue. And Stephanie and Blake, you know, kids are taking their parents' opioids out of their bathrooms, getting hooked on them, and within a year they're on heroin. And because they, what this changes the brain. What happens is now, just to feel normal or keep from feeling sick, they need to have these drugs, and they'll do anything for them. And heroin has gotten so cheap that that they can, they really find that this is kind of an on-ramp for heroin addiction. The 2020 program that we mentioned in the last two webinars actually addresses this in a very tragic tale of a couple. So on slide 39, we just want to remind everyone, this is kind of an integrated diagram that we developed years ago with Dr. David Klassen, with information from Dr. Leap and Dr. Bates, Harvard researchers, to really be able to show the overlap between error and harm. And there are medical errors, what we would call a medical error or a violation of the five rights of medication management, that can be errors but not harm. And there is harm that don't fit the precise description we all use in nursing school for error. But the issue that I'd like to bring up is that this upper left quadrant of the slide on history taking and ordering of the meds and the choices that can be made are absolutely critical. So this is the issue that I think we need to recognize, is that decisions of clinicians and caregivers and policies, now that we have the issue of the FDA and CDC guidelines, are key. I'll just bring up then our Care University program, where we'll have educational materials coming out on the five rights of pain care. We just polished up a training module with continuing education credits for CEUs, nurse practitioners, doctors, and multiple disciplines to address the way that we need to tackle pain management, and that those are the right tests, the right diagnosis, the right treatment, the right monitoring, and the right prevention. So the right tests have to be done. I spoke this morning with one of our close colleagues in predictive analytics who has a back problem. And as we've learned about back pain, one must consider things that affect the spinal cord, the vertebral bodies and the discs, number one. Number two, one has to consider the nerve outlet areas where the nerve roots come out of the spinal cord. And the third are the facet joints of the back. And unless you look at all three of those structural elements, you're not really understanding what is the etiology of back pain, and one can't make a good decision without the right tests and the right diagnosis. And they're typically in back pain, they're a mixture of those three, the structural issues, the nerve outlet issues, and the facet joints. And so when we pick our treatment, we need to pick it accordingly, and what's short-term versus mid-term versus long-term, and then monitoring that pain, and then preventing those pain issues from returning, especially when the risk is so great with these conditions. Now, we also address the active shooter topics, and we just want to draw your attention to our prior webinars. We've done now three that have addressed this on active shooter readiness for hospitals. We have leaders from MD Anderson. We had a number of folks address this, and the fact that these issues are critical. We just want to remind you that active shooter events are one in the top five causes of death in school children, K through 12, and our colleges. We know that one of these events is occurring somewhere in the United States every week. We also know that one is occurring in a hospital every week. They're all not making the news because they're copycat. They tend to stimulate others in doing it. And so the numbers are here. We've shown them in prior webinars. I just want to remind you, for those that have just come on board, go back and look at those webinars on active shooter readiness. And the numbers that came from the work, the report in the 2020 review by Diane Sawyer. It turns out that a lot of these numbers, like how many people had information prior to the planning of a shooting and who got guns from families and friends, the data on these, and we've now been interviewing a lot of people about hospitals in preparation for a threat management program, are very similar to schools. So when we talked about multidisciplinary approaches to threat management, and again, reminding you of our prior webinar, because this sets up our discussion today of the leading causes of death of children in schools and colleges and in our medical schools, and we cover threat management, but it really is important that we understand that we had 55 different hospitals in 2014 that had an active shooter event. There are now more than one a month in U.S. hospitals, and since we're doing some collaborative work in Texas, there were three in Houston, where I am today, 39 people killed, 18 wounded. A 2014 study also showed the victimization of employees and how these are related to intimate partner violence. So as you look at the continuum, it's critical. We ask you, would you or your organization like more on threat management? You said you wanted it, and that's why today's webinar that as we look at the high-impact care hazards. We ask you, would you like a community of practice with monthly webinars? Smaller number, but still a high number, and we are going to now, in September, we'll be launching a managed program with monthly webinars that will be separate, and it'll be out this week. Would you like multidisciplinary webinars that include patient safety and quality, risk management, security, and law enforcement leaders? And 62% of you gave 10. And so we're taking your guidance on establishing this community of practice. So that leads us to set up Dr. Botz and Dr. Peabody. And it was give you the CDC, the 10 leading blue column across the top, and I know it'll be hard to read, but in children, unintentional injury across the board up to the age of 44 is the top cause of death. It's interesting that suicide is from 10 to the age 34, and frequently drugs are the cause of that. And then you can see that homicide is actually the second leading cause of death in 15 to 24-year-olds. So our college students today, you know, that is... If you look at the leading causes of injury deaths by the group highlighting unintentional injuries, these are injuries, and we'll cover transportation injuries today and those that are not related in schools and in colleges and graduate schools, you can see that in the motor vehicle traffic are right up there for children aged 5 through 24. But then you can see these other causes of death, and it's amazing how many kids, 5 and young people to the age of 24, are impacted by violence. And that takes me to the next line. I'm on slide 54. The 10 leading causes of death, injury by group, highlighting violence-related deaths. Now you really start to see the pattern and why it's so important that we consider the violent intruder and the active shooter as a patient safety and a caregiver safety issue in our hospitals, especially since as many of them are happening in hospitals are happening in schools, and it's a totally different issue that we have to really deal with. And who would have ever thought 10 years ago or even 1999 when Lucian Leap's Harvard study was reported to Air as Human that we would today in 2016 be talking about violence as being one of our issues we had. Are going, and if you look at a frequent event, we really need to address it. So when we look at K through 12, this is the best review, and it's by Stephen Satterley, and the breakdown of school-related fatalities. I spoke with the leader of Safe Havens International, Michael Dorn, who's done more threat assessments in schools than anyone in the world. They're a nonprofit organization, and he reported to me that the government is not even collecting the causes of death of kids in schools, so nobody has really good data. Looks like the top five we will cover today. And he said it is likely that the data for the deaths of medical emergencies leading causes of death in schools. He's seeing it over and over again as real unpreparedness for cardiac arrest, for anaphylaxis, and for a number of these issues. He's also an investigator for the majority of the active shooter events. So he was an investigator for Columbine and report on that. And the others in the Northeast, and I won't rattle off the names that you all know of these Virginia Tech, but he has been Sandy Hook. He's been involved in all of them, and being a pattern, and he sees growth in it, and he also sees a lot of potential prevention, but this is going to be a problem. And he said the medical causes of death are just flat, that they're very, very important. On slide 57, if you look at the breakdown of the causes of death, and you look at active shooter, 4% of those, and we look at the medical deaths are included in these reviews, it's critical. So as we lead into Dr. Botz, I just wanted to draw your attention to this lovely little girl. This is a 5-year-old little girl. This picture was taken 4 days ago at Stanford. And the nurse that is in the flight uniform to the right flies with Dr. Botz. When he goes on vacation, he goes into that helicopter and teaches those nurses critical care and how to manage critical care issues for patients. This little 5-year-old girl was at school, had cardiac arrest. The teachers had CPR training to get their job, but no currency. So they were not current, which we'll address in our med tech certification course that we'll talk with Blake Settle about. This little girl's heart stopped. A bystander started CPR. They kept the CPR going. They called 911. The first responders came. They got her to Stanford, kept her alive through CPR. They had to do CPR all the way. They got to Stanford, found out that she had a block, an electrical problem with her heart, which is not uncommon, and put a pacemaker in. And she spoke to the group to thank them and also to challenge them to do what we're talking about with our medical tactical course. So it was really exciting to have Dr. Botz send this to me, and her parents authorize us to not only show this picture, but she'll be part of the video sequence of our med tech course. So I'd like to introduce Dr. Greg Botz. He's actually on the helicopter today, so he recorded this for us so graciously. He's a professor of the Department of Critical Care at MD Anderson, where I am today. But as I say, he's also got a clinical appointment at Stanford and is one of the leaders in patient safety and undertaking a lot of patient safety work. He is the director of the simulation center for MD Anderson. They have a whole floor in a building where they are simulating critical care events. He's just recently been appointed the medical director for the University of Texas and MD Anderson Police Department. They have their own police department taking care of about 20,000 caregivers here in Houston, and working with the first responders, teaches the course on active shooter and these critical issues about developing medical lanes, what to do with mass casualty, and how we can be prepared to take care of our patients and families in hospitals when these events occur. So I'm going to play that tape. I'm going to go on mute. Sorry for the noise in the background. I'm in frequent flyer lounge here in Houston, so I'm going to mute my phone. And Kyle, would you play Dr. Botz and all of that slides?
Well, it's great to be here again to address an issue that's very important to our healthcare community. With the previous webinars looked at serious issues with workplace violence and active shooter events, but I think with data shown from your previous webinars, we have more events that are high impact care hazards to our patients, our caregivers, and our communities that we really need to address more tactically. And when I say that, I mean we have to take a medical tactical approach that clinical and non-clinical people can use to try to reduce the loss of life and harm from very common hazards. The most significant hazards to our community include anaphylaxis, unexpected cardiac arrest, a choking, opiate overdoses, and transportation accidents. And really, these hazards are sort of below the waterline, but have significant impact on our communities. The first issue to address is anaphylaxis. A significant number of school-age children now are coming to school with food and environmental allergies that cause very significant reactions when exposed. And so having an epinephrine pen available for mitigation of that threat is not unusual in schools. the American Heart Association has guidelines that recommend the use of epinephrine auto-injectors for anaphylactic reactions. However, the actual application is not really easy to use. We find that even though people have been trained in the use of epinephrine pens, they may be reluctant or fail to act or recognize an epinephrine requiring anaphylactic reaction. And so the next health hazard would be unplanned or unexpected cardiac arrest. I think we all recognize that there are events in our communities where young, healthy people playing actively in sporting events suddenly collapse and are found to be in cardiac arrest. Most often from a unrecognized congenital abnormality like cardiomyopathy. And being able to recognize and mitigate these with early CPR, early effective CPR and defibrillation so that we have the best chance at reversing this unexplained or unexpected event is so crucial to the survival of our patients. The American Heart Association has guidelines that all of us in healthcare follow for basic life support. But the actual recognition and application in the community is less than perfect performance. We want high-quality CPR during these events and the early application of defibrillation, if appropriate, in order to give the best chance at recovery of a perfusing rhythm. Another health hazard is choking. We know that a foreign body obstructing the airway can cause significant hypoxemia and lead to injury or death. And being able to recognize and intervene is so important. So we've all learned about the Heimlich maneuver in cause an obstruction in the airway to be expelled and allow a patent airway to be reestablished. But the practice of such maneuvers is very infrequent. And so the chance that someone will recognize it and act is often lacking. The impact of opioid overdoses and use in our communities is becoming a pandemic. And a number of organizations are addressing this very serious threat to our population. In a previous webinar, this topic was discussed, but even more community-based interventions are being proposed in order to reduce the unnecessary and preventable deaths that happen from opiate overdose. In fact, recently, the University of Texas Student Governance requested from the administration that the UT police and the dormitory leadership have access to Narcan. And why is this such an issue? Since 2010, the number of opiate-related deaths has almost tripled. Now, this is a huge increase with very preventable deaths in young, healthy people who get addicted to opiates, most often from prescription medications, and then either have an overdose with that or move into other illicit drugs like heroin, unknown concentrations of opiates, and have respiratory arrest and cardiac arrest associated with an overdose. Well, the interventions are relatively simple. If a person is recognized as having an opiate overdose, opening the airway and providing respirations is often life-saving. Also, administering a dose of Narcan, the reversal agent for opiates, is often enough to reestablish spontaneous respirations. And we know from community programs, we can teach all sorts of people to administer these save shots of Narcan. This has been done in school kids and been shown to be an effective intervention to administer Narcan to someone with evidence of an overdose. More recently, we've seen the availability of a Narcan auto-injector, which is used to deliver a standard dose of Narcan to someone who is suspected to have an overdose. It's a relatively easy device. It's analogous to the epinephrine pen. Comes in a case to protect it from exposure. You pull the device from the case, and the device actually talks to the person and tells them how to administer it. The device has a red cap which covers the needle so that there isn't an inadvertent exposure to the provider. You pull that red cap out and hold it against the person's outer thigh and press firmly until the device engages. It will give you an indication that it is engaged, and it will deliver a dose of Narcan, even through clothes, over a 5-second injection period. And once that 5 seconds is completed, you can remove the device and put it back in the case for safe disposal. That delivery device is sufficient for usually reducing the respiratory depression effects of an opiate overdose. In fact, it can be life-saving. We talked about violence in the workplace, and the most significant or severe form being the active shooter events that can occur in healthcare institutions. I think we're all very concerned about the number of hospital shootings that have taken place. This data from 2014 shows that there were events in 55 different hospitals, including some very near to where I practice. Of those events, 39 people were killed and 18 people were wounded. This is a very significant morbidity and mortality, but I would offer to you that the number of active shooter events is actually a lot fewer than the number of events in the other categories that we've discussed today. But if there are active shooter events, we need to understand why our healthcare institutions are different from other public areas where active shooter events might take place. We know that healthcare institutions have high stress in patients and families, and also in the caregivers that are trying to take care of an increasingly sick patient population with increasingly difficult workloads. We have to deal with giving bad news, clinical decline in our patients, and often disclosing medical errors that take place in our environment. We often have caregivers that come to work with domestic violence issues at home, and that domestic violence can often follow them to the workplace. We have a very high concentration of vulnerable patients, and in our patients, the ability to evacuate them from a very high threat active shooter area is not easy. It's very complex. We have life support equipment, medical gases, emergency power issues that need to be considered in moving some of our very sick patients to other locations. And more importantly, I think it's important to recognize that our caregivers won't abandon our patients. If there's an active shooter event or a workplace violence event in the clinical setting, although it's very frightening, our healthcare providers won't abandon their patients. In previous webinars, we've talked about the left of boom theory, where boom is the event, and anything that we can do to move leftward to try to either identify, deter, or defeat those events is worthwhile. The left of boom theory comes from the military when they looked at trying to break the chain of improvised explosive devices that they have had to deal with in recent campaigns. So the question is, how prepared are you when an event happens? Help is not coming quickly, so what are you prepared to do in order to mitigate the problem at the time? And I would offer to you that just as we have learned in many other aspects of our performance in patient safety, there are performance gaps in our reaction. In fact, there's often a gap between how we think we behave and perform and how we actually behave and perform. And in these high threat instances, it's really important for us to have a plan and practice it so that we can affect the best action in a quick response in order to save lives. So what's the solution? Well, a number of organizations have put out different strategies for dealing with workplace violence or active shooter events. The FBI has been supporting the run, hide, fight strategy, which teaches people how to react in these high stress, very threatening circumstances. But whatever strategy you do, we need to formulate a plan and practice it frequently in order to make sure that we have an effective response. We spend a lot of time doing life support training, both basic and advanced life support. We need to expand that also into some of the skills that would be needed in an active shooter event or workplace violence event in order to save lives. And that is to address issues of bleeding and airway obstruction and other problems that can occur in those environments that aren't really common in our regular health care. In fact, the American Heart Association in their guidelines talks about dealing with trauma emergencies, particularly bleeding, and the importance of providing a direct pressure over the wound to try to reduce the amount of bleeding. But also the use of tourniquets now is returned to favor, and teaching people how to place a tourniquet on an extremity that has an injury with significant bleeding is now a very important life-saving intervention. It should be practiced regularly. I think the most important thing that we can do in hospital environments that are at risk for active shooter or workplace violence is to practice. Having a hospital active shooter training program is essential. It's important to conduct an assessment of your vulnerability in various areas of your hospital. Identify evacuation routes where your staff can move quickly to get away from harm. if they can't get away and use an evacuation route to prepare a safe hiding place so that they aren't seen or heard by the active shooter and draw attention to themselves and perhaps become a victim. We need to establish effective access control systems so that when there are reduced staff in place, there aren't as many doors that are open automatically so that people could get in and cause harm. You need to maintain a facility-wide communication plan so that everybody knows when an event like this takes place. Because our tendency is when there are emergencies is to rush toward them, like when there are code blue events or other medical emergencies. In this circumstance, we want people to move away from the emergency. It's really crucial to train your staff to work with law enforcement so that you can integrate their law enforcement skills with your medical skills to save lives. Most people in active shooter events that die after the shooting has stopped, and they die because they haven't received the necessary interventions to stop bleeding, open an airway, or reduce attention pneumothorax. Some skills that are important are to use plain speak, keep it simple, take action, and practice. Practice, practice, practice. The final category of harm that we want to talk about is transportation accidents. This is surprising because we don't often think about this as health hazards in our community, but as you can see, there are very significant injuries that take place to children around automobiles. This pie chart shows the child fatalities by type over the period of 2006 to 2010, and we can see that front-over accidents where a vehicle drives over a patient or a person in front of them, or a back-over injury from backing over someone when you can't see them in your blind spot, are very significant hazards. As well, the heat stroke potential for children that are left in vehicles in hot environments. Now, at least 50 children are backed over by vehicles every week, and about 4% of those die from those injuries. If we look practically at our field of vision in vehicles, this is a very dramatic demonstration of our limited view through our rearview mirror and side mirrors. This is a picture of 62 children sitting in the blind spot of this vehicle. A driver in that vehicle looking through his rearview mirror and side mirrors can't see these kids. And so if they're not paying attention, or as many people are, a hurry to move away from the school environment to go on to other activities, if you don't see the kids, you can run over them. And this is a figure that's showing the number of backover fatalities that there have been since 1990 to 2012 across the United States. The next graphic shows us that rearview cameras can help reduce backover accidents. Each year, there are about 300 deaths and 18,000 injuries due to backover accidents, and almost half of those are in kids under the age of 5. About 70% of those events, a parent or a relative is behind the wheel and rolls over their family member. That's a staggering statistic. In addition to transportation accidents, there are a number of non-transportation accidents that are a significant threat to our communities, and that includes gravity-related accidents where items are left in places where children can get to them. And you can imagine things like a rolling cart in school that has a television on top, and the kid try to pull the cart along or get up to the TV and pull the TV over onto themselves, causing significant injury. There are also injuries from falls from objects that are elevated that kids are trying to get to. It's just as simple as leaving a rope or a cord in a public area where kids have access. There are a number of instances where there's accidental hanging by leaving those ropes and cords in a place where kids can get to them. And obviously, we always think about playground accidents while playing sports and the injuries that can be incurred from those events. Now, the final topic is something that we know is important in our workplace and very important in our schools, and that's bullying. In a previous slide, Dr. Denham described the GAO report on workplace violence, and I think that's a very important document for us that guides our thinking about the risk for workplace violence and implores us to put in place plans to try to mitigate workplace violence and have a plan on how to de-escalate aggression and de-escalate violence. Violence is very common in the workplace, and I was very surprised to see these statistics about violence against hospital nurses. A survey in 2014 showed that 76% of all nurses surveyed experienced some form of workplace violence. Our healthcare workforce is at risk for workplace violence significantly. That includes verbal abuse and physical abuse by patients and visitors, and it's a very significant threat to the safety of our healthcare environment. More recently, the National Academy of Medicine has published a work on preventing bullying, and some surprising conclusions are that there's not enough evidence to conclude that bullying is a causal factor for suicides or a causal factor in school shootings. But I think we all know that bullying is a very deep-seated problem in our society and can lead to some very untoward consequences, both in our children and in our society as a whole. We have to do a lot more to understand bullying and its impact on our communities. So to just summarize, I've taken you through the high-impact care hazards to our communities, including our patients, our students, and our coworkers, including the five major categories here. And I think that in conclusion, I'd like to say that we need to take a medical tactical approach. We need, as healthcare workers, to be involved in the solutions to these problems by education and training of ourselves and our community to try to take these high-impact care hazards, which are frequent, severe, preventable, and measurable, and put in place lifeline behaviors that help to reduce, mitigate, or eliminate the risks to people so that we can save lives. Thank you.
So it's a real pleasure to work with Dr. Botz, and we'll be working on this threat management work through the summer. through the summer, and we'll talk about this program, certification program that will address these areas. What I'd like to do now is shift gears just for a moment and have Dr. Peabody, Dr. Toph Peabody, who's an assistant clinical professor at the Department of Emergency Medicine at the University of California, San Francisco, who we've known for a number of years and met him when he was a Zuckerman Fellow at Harvard, and in a program between the School of Public Health and the Kennedy School of Leadership. And he stepped up when I gave a talk there and said, hey, I'd love to get involved in patient safety and quality, and has worked with us in numerous capacities and finished his residency at USC Emergency Medicine Program, one of the busiest in the world, and is bringing to us and bringing to the national community a perspective on health information technology, but also bringing an enormous amount of value to us regarding a program that he helped launch called Dream Team. And so what we'll have him do is the first thing that we'd like him to do is to address, and Kyle, if you could move to the next slide. We've got a repeat slide there of this medical tactical sort of approach that we've talked about. And then maybe have Toph cover each of these topics and just react to each one before he gives us the update on the Dream Team program, and then we can turn to our other reactors. Toph is a terrific clinician, great educator, and has done undertaken a number of international programs and supported a number of programs with his with the great work he's doing. And we see that he is really going to lead us in emergency medicine and health information technologies, as well as this medical tactical approach from the emergency medicine standpoint. Toph?
Chuck, thanks so much. It's great to be back on one of the webinars, and I appreciate the just vast amount of material that Dr. Botz just went over. I would like to just go over maybe from the emergency medicine perspective, just taking these one by one and doing exactly what you wanted me to, which is just to give a little bit of reaction and a perspective to these many different and diverse topics, and something that I think patient safety and quality improvement people need to look at. Anaphylaxis is the first one you have up there, and it was just incredible the story that you told about the young woman who had bystander CPR and was able to be given epinephrine for her anaphylaxis, which is life-saving. We, in the emergency department, when everyone's diagnosed with anaphylaxis, actually send people home with an epinephrine pen, an auto-injector pen that the patient or their family member can inject when they have one of these anaphylactic events. with the amount of allergy that we've been seeing and the amount of anaphylaxis in recent years, this has become even more important, especially in our schools, and getting people trained in our communities, kind of going upstream or left of boom, as Greg put it, is going to be really pertinent to treating and addressing anaphylaxis. Same thing with cardiac arrest. We've noted in recent years, especially in the emergency department, we have much better outcomes if bystander CPR is initiated right away. Now, bystander CPR with a focus on chest compressions and getting an AED if available. The story that you told earlier, where the AED was kind of unable to be located in a reasonable amount of time, is something that we all need to kind of look at in our organizations. When we're training in CPR, where is the AED located? And then also when we're training in CPR, that big focus on high-quality chest compressions will save lives in the future. Choking, I don't have much to react on. I think Greg did a great job there. This is all about learning kind of the Heimlich maneuver and some airway maneuvers and kind of preventing choking, especially this is going to be become more important as our population ages. And so I think we can start to see that in our aging populations, when especially post-stroke, et cetera, these are people that are high risk for choking. And if you work in those populations, I think your staff should be trained on that, on some of the maneuvers that Greg had mentioned. Now, I want to spend a little more time on opiate overdose, and that's mostly because of the amount of attention that it's been getting in recent times, and that is because there has been so many overdoses, and it's over about 150 per day in the United States right now. And that's according to, 125 Americans a day die from opioid overdoses, according to the CDC, and those are 2014 figures. This has become an incredibly hot topic, especially for emergency departments and our prescribing practices of opioids. About 10 years ago, there was a big push to continue to treat patients' pain and to do that adequately, and only a patient could tell you how much pain they were in. And there was a big push to start prescribing more and more of these opioids. We've now seen this come full circle in that we're actually maybe causing more harm than good when we're prescribing these medications. The one thing I'll add to Greg's comments is that naloxone can save lives. So Narcan pens, the demonstration that he gave, can save lives. And since 2003, the community where I work in San Francisco, the Harm Reduction Coalition, in partnership with the city and county of San Francisco, has been taking a harm reduction approach throughout the entire city and actually gives out Narcan to community members, much like epinephrine pens. So if patients come to the emergency department and had an overdose, much like when people come to the emergency department with anaphylaxis, we actually prescribe Narcan and give them a Narcan kit, give them the training that the patients will need to recognize an overdose, and give them the actual tools as well. This has been an incredibly successful program, and since 2003, there have been about 2,000 overdoses reversed in the community prior to an ambulance arriving, prior to a physician becoming involved in patient's care. So these are friends of people who are that have witnessed overdoses, or the patients themselves that are starting to recognize overdose, that are giving Narcan in an atomizer that has been prescribed from the city and county of San Francisco, has made an exception to the prescribing practices here, and we're actually able to give this out to members of our community after they've gone through certain trainings. So I find that is a very innovative approach in a public health approach to this opioid overdose situation that we've been seeing throughout our country. And I think that type of program will be spread across the country once everyone realizes its success. I'd like to skip down to kind of to active shooter at this time and give you a few thoughts on this. One, my residency, actually, in LA County, USC, there was a major active shooter event where assailant came into the emergency department with a weapon, and members of the healthcare team actually died because of this event in the early 2000s. And it's been near and dear to my heart ever since, as I've had colleagues that have gone through and witnessed an active shooter event in the hospital itself. One thing that communities, especially I know in Charlotte, North Carolina, where my colleague Dave Calloway does a lot of training in active shooters, is that the community itself will now needs to focus on how they react to active shooters. And just to add to what Greg has said, a lot of active shooter training is actually going to saying, now we need to secure the emergency department. So no matter where in the hospital the active shooter event happens, the emergency department is going to see the victims of those active shooters. And so law enforcement personnel needs to be trained that they that certain amount of them, instead of going to defuse the active shooter event itself, a few people need to come back and secure the emergency department so that the shooter doesn't come to the emergency department, because that's where the victims of the crime are going to be brought. I can't emphasize enough the tourniquet administration is becoming more and more of a regular practice, and we're starting to train members of the community for this as well. Going down to the last topic on bullying, from the emergency department's perspective, our nurses on the front lines, our frontline staff, see this every single day. We really, as hospital administrators, need to recognize that certain parts of our hospitals will see more patient abuse, where patients are intoxicated and primed to be more aggressive. One of those places are in the emergency department, and we see a lot of bullying from patients to our frontline healthcare workers. And that kind of leads me into my next topic, because if you work in that type of environment, how do you stay positive and how do you prevent burnout, especially in places that are such high risk and have a high amount of bullying, like the emergency department itself? So, Chuck, I hope that's a decent overview of my thoughts on kind of these high-impact care hazards that we were talking about previously. And I'd like to transition to the update on our project, the Dream Team project. And some of you may have remember this because we presented the initial project on one of these webinars before. And so I'd just like to go over exactly what the Dream Team project is. This all started when I started looking at physician training itself, and started looking at our physicians and how we were training them. We take the most compassionate, idealistic students in the world, and believe me, I've been looking at the resumes of a lot of students applying to med school and now applying to our residency, and it is just amazing the caliber of students that we're continuing to get. Applying to UCSF and other universities that I've been involved with. We take these compassionate, idealistic students and then put them through the crucible of residency, and then we essentially are making burnt-out attending physicians. And that's borne in the evidence. About 65% of emergency medicine residents experience burnout. Some specialties have a high of 80% of their residents are burnt out. And it doesn't get better once you're in practice. About 50 to 65% of emergency medicine attendings that are working in the community experience burnout. And emergency medicine nurses, and I know a lot of other specialty nurses that are on the front lines dealing with patients, having to deal with bullying, et cetera, have even higher rates of burnout. Now, what dream teams are is they're peer-to-peer mentorship groups. Now, these peer-to-peer mentorship groups are there to hold each other accountable for their dreams. So there's about groups of 4 to 5 people. We've done this with incoming interns and residents. to have 4 to 5 people become their own board of directors. Only your peers know exactly what you're going through when you're going through a training program such as residency, or when you're doing the daily practice of being an emergency physician or a emergency medicine nurse. And so what we've started to do is take people in small groups of 4 to 5, give them supported time to help and do some guided facilitations around burnouts and around job satisfaction, around patient safety, around what happens when we deal with medical errors, and start to, these are basically peer-to-peer mentorship networks that act as the people's own personal board of directors. So a dream team is your peers that help hold you accountable for your dreams, hold you accountable for the reasons why you went into medicine in the first place, hold you accountable for being that compassionate, idealistic student and transferring all that energy back into why you were being the physician, the nurse, the staff member that you had went into medicine in the first place for. So we've had some successes. This is a model of how we've been doing this with our residents, and that we have the chief residents kind of facilitate these dream teams about once a quarter. And students are really, and learners and residents are really starting to respond well to this. So the impact, we've discussed shared strategies for work-life balance in these groups. We've utilized these networks of peers for career development. We've discussed research projects, and we've used this opportunity to kind of discuss medical errors in a environment that's supportive. And this is something that we've been kind of looking for a lot in the past 10 years. How do we actually learn from our errors, and how can we talk about it as physicians in a way that's non-punitive? And we found that these dream teams, these peer-to-peer mentorship networks, have been a great opportunity for that. This is my dream team back at LA County. And, you know, what people have asked me is, great, this is great in the learning environment, but has there ever been anything shown after physicians get out of residency? And there actually has, and this is a randomized control trial from the Mayo Clinic, where they actually took practicing internal medicine physicians, outpatient physicians, who were assigned, essentially randomized, into two groups. One group was for essentially what I'm calling the dream teams, but it was monthly facilitated networks, peer-to-peer networks. And then the second group was basically, they just gave the physicians time off, okay? So you said, okay, either you're in this facilitated group, we're going to give you protected time, we're going to pay you for your time for an hour every month. You either have time off or you are in this facilitated network. And they looked at the burnout rates between the two groups, and what they found was that the groups that actually had the facilitated network, the groups that had this kind of like a dream team program, actually had better burnout scores than their colleagues who got the time off instead. And so we've been seeing that if we invest in staff happiness, we can prevent burnout and we can improve safety. And that's the ultimate goal. So now we need to even go left of boom even further. And so I'm really happy to say that with the help of TMIT, we're going to start doing this community of practice with pre-medical students so that we actually have the structures of peer-to-peer mentorship networks and the ability to talk about concepts within patient safety, the ability to talk about error in a supportive environment. With pre-medical students so that the culture is already there once they start medical school. So we're going into medicine with a network of peer-to-peer mentors to help people get through that crucible of medical school residency and then have a successful, passionate practice after they graduate. And Chuck, I'm just really excited to have this project start, and we're starting it next week with some University of Texas students, and we also have some students at the University of California, Berkeley, that are also interested in joining us. And I think these pilots will be useful to see if these programs can be started at such an early time within a long training process that it takes to work in medicine. So with that, thank you very much.
Well, great, Toph. We really appreciate your contribution to this and the great help that you've given us. It's just your dedication to patient safety and quality is just enormous, and you've been on authenticity of your desire to help fellow students and fellow colleagues is great. If Kyle, if you'd hand over the advancement mechanism to me, I'm going to move to the slide right after the references slide in your deck. And and what we're going to do is have our reaction panel, reactor panel. You know what we'll do? It looks like the latest deck one slide did not make it. So if you want to go to slide 105, Kyle, slide 105, or turn it over to me. Why don't you turn it over to me and I'll go to slide 105. And we're going to talk about addressing this issue of tactical medical issues. Looks like I didn't get slide 105. And what we're going to be doing over the summer is addressing and building a course, a 10-hour knowledge transfer component, 10 hours of immersive simulation that will give those that take the course the CPR training for the American Heart Association, the use of the defibrillators, and understanding on how to use the Narcan device as well. Sorry for the noise here at the airport. But we are going to tackle this medical tactical approach and have a med tech or a medical tactical certificate course that has the combination of knowledge transfer, immersive simulation, and competency development. And this will be targeted on children of the age of 10 and above to adults. And it will be undertaken to target the major areas of anaphylaxis, cardiac arrest, choking, opioid overdose, the mass casualty issues and bleeding that we talked about in order to help have impact on the K through 12 students as well as college students, as well as we have a number of medical schools that will be involved in this and universities in Houston, and we'll be starting a community of practice to then support that after it's done. So what I'd like to do is invite Stephanie Settle to respond. Stephanie is a University of Texas student in Austin and is in Austin now, just finished finals, and has been there while this opioid issue has been undertaken, and the demands of the students for Narcan to be available because the opioid overdose issue is such a crisis. And so, Stephanie, do you want to kind of react to the course, and then we'll have Blake talk in more detail about the course, as he'll be the co-founder leader of it. Stephanie?
Yes. Students here at UT have come to realize like how much of a problem opiate use is, and just realizing how important it is to spread this awareness. And so we're excited to have this panel to be able to spread the awareness of Narcan. And we're really excited to help prevent the further use of it.
Well, great. And we'll come back to you, Stephanie, regarding your leadership of the pre-med dream team approach. But I want to go over to Blake. Blake, we are going to be building the course out over the summer with Dr. Botz and Dr. Peabody and a number of physicians and there'll be two tracks. One track is because we'll produce the course to then make it a gift to the Boy Scouts of America so it could be taught by I'll Teach, I'll Learn and an I'll Teach, I'll Learn framework so that Scouts and Eagle Scouts will be able to train the Cub Scouts and have kids from 10th grade from the age of 10 and above, and those that are strong enough to do the CPR course so that they can earn the certificate. pushed together over the summer, and then we'll be launching this and making it available in fall. Do you believe that there are enough young people that will be willing to take these courses and then bring them into the high schools? And we'll probably be starting with Houston and some cities in California.
Dr. Denham, as a previous Eagle Scout, I can really see the need for this program within scouting and all young students. I think it would be very beneficial to teach kids while they're young to prevent some of these leading causes of death. And hopefully by this fall, we can fully plan to bring back this program to this audience.
I think that we'll be piloting and testing this and then globally. So focus will be through our Care University program, which is intended to be able to, for caregivers, it'll deliver CME, CEU units, as well as nurse practitioner units, and a special certification program for younger people and for families. And we'll be using the aviation model where you earn a certificate, but you have to have competency to continue to confirm it. So like we have in aviation, I'm an IFR pilot and I have a rating for certain aircraft, and I'm have the certificate, but I'm not legal until I've been tested to be current. Top, do you want to kind of react to that before we then move to Arlene and Jennifer regarding this topic, and then we'll do a round of comments regarding Dream Team. But Top, the issue of competency in the illustration we used of the child at Stanford, teachers had to have CPR training to become a teacher, but then they no longer had to redo it. Once they'd had CPR once, that was it. This issue of currency and competency and verification of behaviors.
Yes, Chuck, this goes back exactly to stimulation and doing something repetitively so that you're comfortable with it before the actual emergency happens. And we do this a lot with emergency medicine preparedness, especially with CPR training. This is was a classic example of everyone that needs to have a certificate in CPR, but if you don't have your skills current, if you don't continue to practice, if you don't continue to have that simulation, then when the actual events, such as the cardiac or cardiac arrest this young child had, was something that, without that actual training, we saw that teachers couldn't actually implement it in real time. So having that constant simulation in these types of trainings, and I can see it in some of the topics that we talked about today, anaphylaxis, EpiPen administration, Narcan administration, in the active shooter, tourniquet administration, CPR, the high-quality chest compressions by bystanders in a timely manner. These are things that we all need to have simulation for our communities, and as physicians, we need to be on the front lines of helping provide these for members of our community that left the boom phenomenon that you've been talking about today.
Well, thank you. And before I go to Arlene and Jennifer, I just like our polling program to be put up. And our first polling question for you is, I would like a medical tactical certificate course covering anaphylaxis, sudden cardiac death, choking, opioid OD, and injury care for active shooter events. So these are the mass casualty events. If you believe that we're on the right track with this and want us to remember you when we are distributing it, please give it a high rating. Very strongly agree as a 10. If you don't think that this is valuable, the most negative would be a 1, and we'd like to get your response, your honest response, whether you think this is of value. And this program will be offered actually for schools, but it's going to be offered for all caregivers. And so for your non-clinical staff, research recently a choking and CPR course was given at MD Anderson. The very next day, a young lady that was only 90 pounds in size learned the Heimlich maneuver, performed it on someone that was much larger than she was, and saved his life from a really bad choking incident. And Dr. Botz said he couldn't have been more gratified to hear the story about somebody they trained the very next day. And this was the secretary, who was non-clinical staff, saved the man's life. So this happens. It's not that frequent. You don't see it, in the press, but this is happening all the time. Second question, I would like a webinar on patient and caregiver safety that could be offered to non-clinical staff. So you may be a clinical person, but if you'd like to see a program that we can put together to help with these very common emergencies that can strike families and strike people actually at work, for your non-clinical staff, please give that. The highest rating is a 10. The lowest rating is a 1 if you believe it's just not valuable at all. And then the next question is, what emergency department or ED or emergency topics would you like addressed for non-clinical staff? Again, we're asking you to put in free text content into that. And then the final question is, what are the major questions you want answered about common preventable death in children and young adults? We've got two very dedicated college students on who we'll come back to in just a moment regarding the Dream Team program. What we're finding, as we've been interviewing threat management experts, no one's keeping count of these fatalities and these injuries that are occurring in our colleges, in our universities, and in our schools. And those that are on the front line are saying it's enormous. And then when they try to pull the data, no one's collecting the data. But every time they're out doing an active shooter event program, they're finding out that there are a number of other accidental deaths that occur. Now, they're not so frequent that we would pull the fire alarm and be paranoid, but they're more frequent than anybody thinks because we've just not been collecting the data. So what I'd like to do is have Arlene comment first, and then Jennifer, and then we'll come back on Dream Team comments from Stephanie, who's going to co-lead that with Toph. So Arlene, your comments? Arlene, are you muted?
She is, and I'm having computer glitches here, sorry.
Should we go to Jennifer then while you do that? Jennifer, can we hear your voice?
Hello, yes. This has been a really great webinar, and I think that these issues are really, really important. It seems to me that, we've had issues through patient safety through the years, but now things are even more complicated, and of course they are still, in fact, related to patient safety. I think the work that's being done here and all of the information put forth on this call is the future of safety in our country. I think we need to look at patient safety as part of a bigger picture in this nation right now, and as far as looking at all of the individuals who are needing mental health services, who are, become active shooters and not getting proper counseling, not getting proper medications, that's a big issue, as well as this terrible, terrible exploding epidemic of opioid overuse and abuse. I can't stress enough how important this is, and for everyone on this webinar, please share the audio of this and with others, and I strongly recommend we continue on with these very important issues. Thank you so much, Dr. Denham.
Thanks, Jennifer. And Arlene, do we have Arlene's audio back?
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am. Go ahead.
Okay. This webinar has so many great topics and so many things to discuss, and I don't think we have enough time to do everything. But it was mentioned that we should practice some of these processes that would prevent a lot of these injuries. And I worked on the front line for 11 years in a non-clinical position. We would have fire drills, and we would do it over and over, and that we would do it with such organization, confidence. We knew what to do, and it was through practicing. Even though it may never happen, and it never did happen, it was that practice that gave everybody the confidence. And one thing I want to mention about bullying, and I know the GAO report came out, it didn't mention there's an important issue about coworkers. bullying among co-workers, co-employees. And I think that's a very important issue, and it has a great impact on your employee and the quality of care that they're involved in. So I think that's one thing that should be discussed too. Thank you.
Thanks, Arlene. So I've put up the slide addressing physician training, and now we're going to be looking at pre-med students. And I'd like to kind of come back to the fact that we're launching this new program to extend the successes that TOP has had with residents and the evidence that supported there to help pre-med students who have very intense schedules and have very similar characteristics to some of the residency programs that that suffer high burnout rates. Stephanie, can you comment? You're a co-founder of this program, and you're going to be the national founder of it, and then help other organizations once we get chapters started, very much like the IHI Open School. We're going to look for leaders across the country who want to lead a local program, and Stephanie is piloting this and has stepped up to do this and with students in Fort Worth, Dallas-Fort Worth area, Metroplex, and Toph has just mentioned California and Austin, Texas. And Stephanie, does burnout really happen in pre-med, and do you think that this mentorship linkage to your core values and your dreams makes sense?
Yes, we are looking forward to working with Dr. Peabody because as a pre-med student, we've come to find that many of these undergraduate students are experiencing the same similar burnout on a different scale. And I think that working with these groups to help expand pre-med burnout and expanding it to other universities to help get through the hard years of organic chemistry and all these weed out classes that many students are, you know, either finishing them and realizing that, you know, it's a lot of hard work and that they may have already finished organic chemistry and decide that they don't want to do it. And so we're looking forward to helping build this group of people to rely on each other to get through these tough classes.
Fantastic. And the issue is the plan is to start small with the pre-med students, but expand dramatically with success as we get our processes right with nursing students. Toph, do you want to address this issue that nursing students are experiencing this as well? Pharmacy students, you know, just everybody across the board in healthcare, because of the intense knowledge base that they've got to absorb so dramatically and rapidly, and the fear and the anxiety that they have as they start to undertake more and more responsible positions. We know that, you know, our goal is not only to go deep vertical in age and go earlier and earlier, but also across the other disciplines. So we don't want to leave nurses out, or pharmacists, or nurse practitioners, or respiratory therapists. Toph, do you want to address the fact that this burnout issue is just not limited to those that are physicians or on an MD track?
Yes, Chuck. I think that one term that we can use is the health profession students, and the entire health profession are ultimately our goal is to integrate these teams, and I've done a lot of work on teams, as you know, and we work together on multidisciplinary teams every day. In my practice in the emergency department, the critical elements of the team require nursing, physicians, techs all working together in unison. And how do we do that well? Well, we need to train together well. We need to have simulations well, and we need to actually focus on our wellness together as well. So I think there's lots of opportunity here. I like that we're starting off as a pilot, and we'll use the evidence to see if these programs are successful before we expand and kind of work on this and cultivate it organically. And I'm looking forward to the opportunity.
Fantastic. Let me come back to Blake. We're going to cross-pollinate these two programs to get folks that are in pre-med, that are in, as Toph has said, the healthcare disciplines area, and really help all of us understand how simulation can be used to build skills, and by cross-linking Dream Team with the MedTech certificate program, we're actually looking after the health of the students that are ultimately going to hopefully become care providers and deal with stress. One of them is long-term stress. One of them is the stress of the fog of war that happens, right at the time. And so one of the reasons we have Eagle Scouts and the scouting program is that we're building on a base of a program that not only has knowledge in first aid, but competency. Well, we're almost out of time. So I think what we'll do is we'll finish on time and we'll bring the med tech or the medical tactical course to you in September. It'll be finished over the summer. We'll be piloting it. We'll be testing it. We'll also provide periodic updates on the Dream Team program. And as we launch chapters of them, and Stephanie leads that nationally, we'll be inviting groups at schools that are interested to have kids that would like to lead such a program do so. Toph, give us a quick 30-second TikTok of how you envision starting a Dream Team, the starting point of really recording the core values and the aspirations that start off the network, and then we'll ask Jenny to close. Go ahead, Todd.
Yeah, starting a Dream Team really has the first starting point is with yourself. So it's all about self-reflection. So one of the exercises that we do when we start these programs is to have people kind of self-reflect and talk about their goals. And then what the community, the Dream Team, or this peer-to-peer mentorship network, what it's for is to hold you accountable and to help you reach those goals. And so the first step always, I think, when we're talking about burnout and preventing it, is first a series of self-reflection exercises. So that's what we'll be doing when we start off, when we launch the new topics of Dream Team as well.
Fantastic. And Jenny, if we still have you on audio, would you like to close us and the speakers just stay on for a minute or two, performance improvement loop on what we could do better. But Jenny, would you please close us?
Yes. Thank you all again so very much. Thanks, Dr. Denham. Thank you all again very, very much for being here today. This is very important, and as I said earlier, this is the future, and thank our speakers so much for all of the information and education you provided us with today. I hope to see more of this in the future, and many blessings to all of you. Thank you so much.
Great. Thank you, Jenny. And I think that this is a little bit different tack of not taking one topic and just a deep dive, but actually taking the most common harmful events and tackling them together. And I think, as Jenny said, I think this is the wave of the future, is really a high impact, high volume events we've got to address. And we just can't just focus on the things we're used to. But these new threats are growing, and have people like Dr. Peabody and Dr. Botz to help lead us through it is terrific, especially when we have young people like Stephanie and Blake that can lead the charge with our younger group. So God bless you all. Hope you have a wonderful month, and we'll see you in June.